Yeah, thank you. Quite curious that there are so many people here. Yeah, we will divide the talk into three small sessions. So the first, I will introduce what smart metering is, or what are we going to hack, or what privacy implications we want to consider. Then Stefan will show you the privacy implication we have, and later on I show you some slides about hacking the smart meter. So what is a smart meter? Smart meter is an electrical power meter at the consumer side. So it's down in your cellar and it measures the power consumption. So why is it smart? It's smart because it's digital, so it's more precise and can measure the consumption very precisely. It has a memory, so it has the possibility to store the consumption over the time. So you don't have an only value, one value that you can read at the end of the year. You can see the power consumption during the whole time. And the other thing which makes it smart is it has a network connection, so it can transmit the acquired data. You are not in the need that you have to go down to the cellar. You can read it out remotely. Yeah, what are the advantages? The advantages is you can measure and optimize your own consumption. When you see how much do you consumed during the last day, and you see that there are some lights switched on, and you see the next day when you switch them off, you gain more money because you don't use so much energy. That is from the consumer point of view. And from the energy provider point of view, that is that they can issue variable service charges. So they can think about having more times the day where the current costs you more, and other times in the night where it's less expensive. And what they say in the internet when you look over smart meters, they say that they helps them to utilize the power infrastructure. Even when everyone is doing solar cells and windcraft, then they need to know about the power, and they say that smart meters are going to help them for this. So what is the hardware for a smart meter? The hardware is typically divided into two parts. So you have an energy meter, which is shown in this picture. So it's a digital measurement instrument. And this is the really payment-relevant device, which is in your cellar. And it's working like the other you had before, which was analog. And maybe it has the possibility to switch different prices and show the amount for different times a day. And attached to this, you can see it here in the upper part, is a gateway. So the gateway does the intelligent stuff. So it can record the data. It has a communication interface to the smart meter. Normally it's via infrared signals. And it has an external interface, TCP/IP, Ethernet, or GPRS. It depends on your local site. And it can transmit the data to any other person. So now let's switch and take some privacy implications.
Hi. Hi. It's okay, so? Oh. Our motivation is that you can read from the different data that is transferred to the energy good. Okay, so first of all, I show something about our motivation. After that, we see our experimental setup. Our motivation is about finding TV films and movies in the power signal transferred to the. Sorry, I'm really nervous. At the end, I show a little demo. So, motivation for privacy is that the smart meter sends consumption data to the energy provider. You can analyze this data. Let's skip that. From the data, Mr. Hart shows in 1992 that you can identify several consumer devices uniquely. So what you see here is, for example, a refrigerator which has three power cycles and six heater cycles, which which are added to the signal. So our experimental setup at the label is an easy meter as power meter and two different gateways. We've used first of all the Theben connector 1.0, which sends one value every 10 seconds. This is not enough, so which for our work, so we switched to a COM1 from COMET, which sends one value per 2 seconds, which is equal to the real world easy meter with meter read setup, which is applied in Dario's cellar, for example. Discovergy is
Discovergy? Yes. Okay, Discovergy is a company which sends you, which installs a smart meter for you and does this thing for you. And they have a web interface, and the client can use this to plot his own data. So here you see the data consumption during a whole day, I think. And in the web interface, there are only the last 3 months available. And it's a basic Zoom functionality, and you can't get the data. There's no API provided to get out the data. And he wants to analyze this data. So as there is no API provided by Discovergy, when you look at the HTTP site and you see what HTTP GET request do you have to do, then you can get all these values based down to one value every 2 seconds. So you can get each value that was sent by the smart meter to the Discovergy site, and you can store them on your local hard disk for further for further calculations that he did. Maybe you want to do the next?
Thanks. So this is a detailed view of the web GUI. At the upper top, there's the invoice value we have pixelized for anonymity. You see the consumption graph of a whole day. It shows the consumer his consumption. Here's a little error in the picture you see. It's based on the daylight saving time in Germany. There's an interpretation error within the data. Discovery shows you less than less information than they saved. These pictures contain the same data. We have downloaded the data from their server. The upper image is from Discovergy web GUI. At the bottom, you see the predicted data with GNUplot. Our goal is to determine which program was running based on power consumption. Not possible, so to be more precisely, we want to determine if a certain program was running. So what we have to do is predict the power consumption of one program and correlate power consumption with the predictive predicted data. Some TV power consumption basics. The power consumption of a TV is relevant. Power consumption of a TV is the brightness of the backlight and the starting position. So I've said before we have one value per 2 seconds, so it's important if the film starts at the first at the beginning of the 2 seconds or at the end. The audio output is negligible, even so the manual brightness adjustment the user does. Interferences can be came from ambient light sensors and program changes. At the bottom we have the difference from highest to lowest consumption of, for example, a plasma TV, which shows us 160 watt with a contrast of 2 million to 1. At this point I have to say that the contrast is
multiplied.
Yeah, multiplied by the brightness of the backlight. So with we've tested another CRT with a difference about 50 watts, which has a contrast of 100,000 to 1 and even two LCD displays. The first has a difference about 3 watts with a contrast of 4,000 to 1 without dynamic backlight, and the second LCD has about 70 watt with 30,000 to 1 as contrast. To predict the power of a film, we have to determine the minimum brightness with max power consumption, so-called BMIN. As we see in this picture, we have three pikes at the beginning to find our test film, and after that we display several frames, which first a black, then a gray one, and after that a white one. The gray frames started at black and runs to white. It's RGB interpreted. We can see that after nearly 30 gray steps, the maximum power consumption with minimum brightness is reached. For the power prediction, we analyze film chunks, maybe 5 minutes we've used in this context. First of all, you see on the left side, the blue graph is the brightness of the frames. We interpret.
So I think I don't know about this. I think the rule one is the brightness of the film. So you take the whole film or film chunk of 5 minutes. You get this 5 minutes and you see the brightness over this 5 minutes. And then as the power meter sees the power consumption during this whole 5 minutes, you're going to predict the power consumption based on this with this nice fancy formula up there, and you get the green one. So this is the predicted power consumption, and when you have in your home only the TV attached, then you have, then we expect that you can see this power consumption in your smart meter. Yeah, I think that's one of...
Much better than mine. Yeah, we have a demo. I think some of you know this movie. The whole movie is about 600 seconds. I've cut it until 26, I think. So, one moment. You see the picture, and at the bottom you see the consumption graph of our TV at home. So the first part of the graph you see, I've cut the first 6 seconds away. So,
Warum hast du eine Maske auf?
Dann blas mir nur ein.
Of course. Yeah. So.
Ja,
jetzt another one.
Ich habe in den Herzen mal gesagt, dass du einen empfindlichen Magen hast. Lass alles raus, Jacqueline. Nicht durch die Nase. Schatz, ich bin gleich wieder da. Das habt ihr jetzt von eurer Raserei.
So, at the top you see the measured consumption of the TV. At the bottom you see the predictive data from the movie files. So as you can see here, it's nearly easy to match even the red graphs are jolted, match this part to this, and so on. So it's easy to find this with your eyes, but there's also a mathematical way. It's the Pearson correlation. Pearson correlation, short, is you get a value about 1 to minus 1. For example, 1 when it's a perfect match. You so closer you come to the 0, as less you have a relationship. So in this context, the signal noise of other devices doesn't matter. As you can see here at the bottom, the overlaid graphs after the Pearson correlation. So, privacy implications in Germany, we also differ between private sphere and intimate sphere. I think there's no English translation for this. With the data transferred to DiscoverG, for example, there's a way to determine your daily routine, direct insight into your private sphere, and even to get a transparent citizen.
Okay, so. Let's add me one thing, because it's the thing I'm very interested in explaining it. This are, which we see here, are data from the laboratory, so it was only the TV. But they did it also in a real world, so they had a house and they had the normal behavior of the whole household, and they showed a film about 1.5 hours, and they took all the data from 1 month, and they were able to find in which time the film was displayed on the telephone in a real world. So, and what the correlation coefficient does is that it gets this template, which you do from the film you want to find, and goes over the whole time and finds if it's matched. And it's not, It's not a point if there is a noise. So even if there is a refrigerator or any other things that are going on, the first thing is the refrigerator is really every 5 minutes, and you can build a filter on this to filter this out. And even the other noise is going to switch out by using a correlation coefficient, and this makes it very powerful. It's not like a game, and we showed it here like doing so in a laboratory. It works really in practice with this 2 seconds intervals. Yeah, I'm true. Okay, so now we're going to do the hacking part. So I'm the electrotechnic guy, and also I'm a Windows user, and I'm not very good programmer, but I was quite curious about this Discover G Smart Meter, and I ordered it, and it arrived at my home, and I looked on their website, and on their website, it's here in German, it's a German website, and it's the former website, the website doesn't exist anymore, this 3 points. They say, how is going to Discover G protect my data? And in the green one, they say that they use a web-based GUI, basically HTTPS, so that if you go to the GUI, to the web front end, and if you enter your password and your data is displayed, everything is secure, everything is encrypted, so there's no problem. The yellow thing says that how is the smart meter talking to their servers? And they say that the smart meter uses only an encrypted way of communicating, so every data is encrypted to provide the confidentiality of the data, and also the data is signed, which means that you have no possibility to alter the data to other values. And the red one says that is expected by independent experts regularly, they say. So I was quite curious about this, and when they installed it for me, it took a day that I got my password, and then I went to this HTTPS server, and when you print in HTTPS, you get a certificate, which is for asterix.discoverg.com, but the server is running on https.discoverg.com, so the issue of the certificate doesn't match to the website, and Firefox shows you this little note, it's a wrong certificate. So then you accept the certificate and say, yeah, it doesn't matter, I'm quite sure that it's true. But then it doesn't show you the HTTPS site, it redirects you to the normal HTTP site. So when you enter your password, all the passwords are entered in clear. So, what?
Facepalm.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I'm quite new here. Normally, it's the Congress is during my birthday, and normally I'm not at the Congress because I'm festivating my birthday. This is the first time that I'm here, therefore I'm not sure how to behave here. So, and data older than 3 months cannot be displayed. So when you have this longer than 6 months, then the older 6 months can't be displayed. But in the previous talk, he showed that using his own interface, he was able to display even, to get even this data. So the display is not because the data is deleted, missing the data. The data is still there on the server, and only the web interface doesn't display the data. So, the first thing, HTTPS is not there, so it's not used, all data is not deleted, and by the way, the password is quite easy to guess. So, when you know someone who has it, the login name and the password is easy to guess. When I know anybody here who has has his name and first name, I can get the password from him, and it's not easy to change the password in the web interface. So I tried it 2 times. There is no web interface link there. You get an email where you can click on it, and then you can change the password, and either the new or the oldest password doesn't work anymore, and you have to phone them up, and they reset the password for you. So we saw HTTPS not there. What is about the smart meter communication? So I said I'm a Windows guy, so internet things are quite curious to me. Wireshark, I never saw it before. So first I started to monitor the smart meter communication. I started with the switch and some sync flooding. On Windows, it's really difficult. So then I found an interface in the Fritzbox which can capture the data. I think everyone here knows it better than me. You can use Wireshark to analyze, and pretty easy even for a Windows user. And then you see that the smart meter sends HTTP post request. Here you see some requests. I hided the MAC address of the smart meter because it's my MAC address. And you see the, it's sent to a fixed IP. It's containing the measurement values in plane. So you see here 000 kilowatt stunden, kilowatt hours, seconds. The seconds was also quite curious because it's not a Linux daytime. It's a daytime, I think, seconds since 3rd of December 1997. I didn't know what happens there, but this is the start of, I had a long time to figure it out. Yeah. So, and there's no cryptographic signature. And I showed it to my wife, and she said, oh, but it's encrypted. It's all encrypted stuff here. And yeah, and it was quite difficult for me to explain to her that it's not encrypted. So, and what we observe is that the smart meter provides its own identity by using its own MAC address. So, there's no protection at all. So, communication from the smart meter to the server is in plain text, not encrypted, not signature, and no MAC. And MAC, by the way, is message authentication code. I think you know it all. So, thus, I was quite curious, can I fake the data? So is it possible for me to fake the data? So I don't want to hack the smart meter. There are some fancy plomben on it and you can't open it and I didn't want to destroy this. So the only thing I thought, so when I send my own packets, it may be a little bit confusing when the smart meter is sending his own packages. So I took out the cable from the smart meter so it had no connection anymore. And I set my own packet, so I had the MAC address of the smart meter, and I emulated the smart meter with my Windows program, and I started to learn Python, because I never had Python before, and a guy told me, you have to go take Python, and I started to make such a triangle, and it was not high enough, so and the second time, a little bit later, you see it was from 2 o'clock to 2:30, I magnified the triangle. And you see it works. It was pretty funny for me. And when you see it, I got the smart meter. So I got the smart meter on June 9th. On 10th, they sent me the password, and this is 2 o'clock p.m. At the third day, I just have hacked it. So it was not a problem for a Windows user, it was not a problem for anyone. So, then I think, oh, when this is... So then Python was very bad for me, and I am Visual Basic guy, so I wrote my Visual Basic guy to print something on the net. So you see, even Visual Basic is not good, or my programming skills are not good. The K and the V are not the same, but you see basically that it's possible to fake all the data. So what other fun can we have? Then based on this, there was an article in a German newspaper, it called CT, when you look at it, I don't know, CT 23, you see it in the last slide. And after this article, my smart meter didn't work anymore. So the article was issued on October, 20th or like this, and 2 weeks later, you see there's no power consumption at all for 2 months. And look on the day where it started working, it was yesterday. So and this web interface is also a little buggy, so this is only for fun. There's nothing faked, only clicking in the web interface without faking data, and I was able to get out that my minimum power consumption was minus 106 kilowatt. Yeah, and then we have the independent reviews from experts, so... Even when I'm not a real expert, but I think we did it, and you can build your own opinion of based off on our results. So what's the summary? The summary is, it works for all smart meters if the make is known. It worked till the day I did it. So if it's now working, we tried it today because we wanted to do the fancy skyline, but it seems that my smart meter was updated, and maybe it's now testing signature or things like this. I was not able to figure it out, but we would have the skyline of Berlin in the background if it was working. So it's quite interesting. The Macs are sequentially issued to the customer. So they have their own Mac range. You can find it in the RAP database. And you will see that, or I could see my own IP address, my Mac address, the last byte. And I know another guy, he has 20, plus 20 from me. So he had it, I think, a month later or 2 months later. And there you see how many smart meters are issued. So, but the experiment I did don't have an effect for the billing, so I did nothing quite wrong, because the fee which I have to pay is calculated once a year. So once a year, the company sends the smart meter to the power consumption from the year to my provider, and I have to pay for this. And when you want to fake it, you have to do it by continuously spoofing the packet. So to get the effect for billing, you have to put a man in the middle attack and to send the packets every time, maybe see your own packets to make it more realistic. And the quite interesting thing is that I could do it for my smart meter, basically knowing the MAC address, and I know the MAC address from every other smart meter client. I can do it for everyone. I can't see if it worked because I don't have the password, but I can do it for everyone. Yeah, and after publishing in the CT magazine, the smart meter didn't send any data. Yeah, our point of view is, yeah, why should we know a should we want a smart meter? So for this point, it is billing relevant information. So Discovergy on their website say, we're gonna find the best provider for you, for your usage. So the German providers are normally not daytime relevant, so you have the same fee for the whole year. And they could get, even when they get only one day value, one value each day, they could also predict what is the best provider for me or the best tariff. Yeah, when we're going to have different rates, so when night rate is less expensive than day rate, then you could transmit even more, but not every 2 seconds. Yeah, from our point of view, when they say on the website the data should be encrypted inside, signed, now it's not more promised on the website. So after this article, you don't find this website anymore. So maybe it's okay when they don't sign it and encrypt it. Yeah, but for me, I'm a nerd guy, and I'm quite interesting in this 2 seconds value. But from the technical point of view, it's really simple to do it. You can put a smart card or like a compact flash card or a small memory card in the smart meter, and you can store all the data there. And from my local net, I can go to the smart meter, maybe with a fancy Windows program or with a web front end on the smart meter. I can also see the detailed information, but I'm not interested in sending all this 2 seconds to everyone in the world. Yeah, so I think we have finished. So open for questions.
Thank you for the talk. So we have a Q&A till the end. We have an audio angel in the back, and here I'm in front, but I will take the first question here, okay?
Could you describe the way how you got the meter? Like, was it an offer from your service provider, or did you go to your service provider and say, I would like a smart meter? How is the normal way for just any Joe who pays a power bill to get this power meter?
Yeah. So it's in Germany. We talk about Germany. In Germany, it's since 1st of January 2010, it's allowed for a company to be a Messstellenanbieter. So they do only the smart meter thing. So it's a company which offers the service for you to measure your current. It's not the energy provider, and it's not the one who has the wire to your home. And you can go on the website, you go to discovergrid.com, you print out a PDF form, and you get this fancy meter after 5 months or so. They come and they take away the old one. So you don't have to pay more for your own provider, the old smart meter or the old meter you have, and you get this fancy smart meter. The service they offer on their website is that they look at your behavior and they say you can change to another tariff and you gain money from this. And if you don't get at least this 60 euros a year, which is their cost, you don't have to pay for it. So in fact, they didn't tell anything to me, so I have the same provider as the last year or as since... June, and I didn't pay anything for this. And I'm living in Bochum, and Bochum is the Stadtwerke. I went there, and as there is also another rule that they have to provide you with a smart meter if you want to, you go to the Stadtwerke Bochum, and it was really funny. I said, I want this funny, fancy smart meter. And they say, yeah, you can have it, but you have to change the tariff. So you're going to get a tariff, which is, I don't know the quite the real numbers, but let's say now I'm paying 20 cents per kilowatt hour. Then they said, you get a new tariff. Daytime is 28 cents per kilowatt hour, and nighttime is 19 cents. And I figured out, even if I get my whole consumption in the night, so 95% of my consumption has to be in the night, that it's I cannot do it without paying more. So they try to do a tariff that nobody wants it. So I got it from Discovergy, and everyone who is in Germany can get it from Discovergy. You can fill out this form and you will get it. Other questions?
As far as I know, the BSI is developing a so-called protection profile for smart meters, which will be mandatory for all coming smart meters in the future. Can you say something about the correlation between your work and the protection profile? Are these attacks possible when the protection profile is in work?
Yeah, let's say. So the protection profile, I don't know if everybody knows it here, so it's common criteria, it's an evaluation, it's independent from the states, and you can go to, if you are a provider and you have a smart card you want to develop, or like a smart meter, then you go there and you say, I want a certification that this is secure. And to define what is secure, it's on your term. You can say it's secure because I say it's green. And then they prove that it's green and then it's secure. And for smart meters, they issued a protection profile. So a protection profile says what is the profile, what is the requirements this device, a smart meter, has to fulfill. And this protection profile has a certain levels, and the level is the level 4, which is like smart cards, the smart cards in your phone. And yeah, if you want to hear my opinion, so first, the work is not related with this. I know about this, I know how is it working. I even know that the protection profile is now being written by the BSI, and then they issue it. You can load it, download it on their website, but you have no rights to comment this, because the comments can only give big institutions like energy providers or like big companies which want to sell smart meters. So we can't go there and give comments on this. So, and in my point of view, I don't know hardware, which is not a smart card, which is evaluated common criteria level 4. This devices you find at the state in Botschaften and things like this, where they're going to transfer this data, because when you want to reach the level 4 for a device, it means that all data has to be destroyed when you open it. So it's really difficult to do this for a smart meter. I never saw a device in my hands, only this diplomacy communication devices, which are in this highest level. So I don't know what I have to think about this. I think it's quite impossible. Maybe it's some politics that small companies are not able to sell smart meters when this is issued and when it becomes law. But I even don't know if it becomes law in the next years. So when you would ask my expectation, it's like reading, looking to the future, reading in a glass ball or things like this.
Okay. Any more questions? Here next to me, one.
Actually, I just want to correct you. You can input this. This is currently being standardized. All this, let's say, the smart grid is being specified and standardized in IEC 61850 on IEC level. You can participate on the German mirror committees at DKE, because every German citizen is allowed to participate. Actually, it's quite hard to find these things if you're not already in, and you only get the documents if you're really a participant of the committees. That's unfortunate.
And a big problem.
And as I know, I have some kind of access to these to those documents. The security stuff is not standardized as of now. They are just starting to talk about it. And so I assume it will take another 2 years at least.
Yeah. So the CAM criteria profile is there. They say that's only allowed from the big companies, but for the IEEE and other standardization stuff, I think it's also possible, yeah.
Hi, you mentioned that your recommendation is to make it so it only uploads the data once per day, but doesn't that defeat the whole purpose of this device, is that that they want highly accurate usage data so that they can trade energy credits and whatever?
Yeah, they want accurate data to track you and, yeah. I don't know, but on the website they say they want to do it for finding the perfect solution for me to get paid. If they want more, they have to do it, yeah, but they don't tell about it. So, sure. Another thing is that they say that it's not this company that is said in the public, when you look on the internet, it said that smart meters gonna help you to use the power grid better. So to know if someone has more power consumption, less power consumption, even when everyone is producing its own power by wind energy or solar energy or things like this. But in my opinion, I'm electrotechnician and I had this energy stuff in the university, and I know that the power provider knows the load of the whole net in the microsecond where the load is. So it's not possible by internet, by measuring it in a home, accumulating every data, sending it via TCP/IP to servers for every German citizen to then get the actual knowledge of the power consumption. They have it just in the second where it consumes, because when they don't able to provide this power, the net breaks down. So I don't know why they want it, but sure, when they want have exact usage from you, then they have to measure this in. Yeah, we have time. I think we have been quite quick.
Yeah. So I have two questions. First, is my understanding correct that you hooked up the power meter just to your DSL modem at home? That
yep.
You just basically used whatever internet you already have?
Yeah. This is for Discovery. Is it like this? It's in their PDF file, which you have to sign. You have to provide the DSL line for their power meter to send. Therefore, I was able to monitor everything.
Okay, and second, your old meter is gone. Are you now stuck with the device? Are you happy about that?
Yeah, I have been at the Stadtwerke Bochum and asked how much does it cost when I don't want it and they have to reinstall it to me. And they said it cost 50 euros and I said, okay, 50 euros, it's okay. And but I signed a contract for 2 years with Discovery. It's like a cellular phone.
You mentioned the net breaking down. I would like to point out something. There's a novel of the renewable energies law in Germany, and it says that certain renewable energy systems have to have a a technical system that allows them to be remotely shut off. I think there are still bets accepted that they will fuck that up. And the law is coming effective in 2 days' time. So it's probably going to be very interesting to have a talk here next year on how to shut down the German power grid, because politicians want to have a possibility for the network operators, which equals in a possibility for hackers.
Yeah, sure.
Hi. I just posted on Twitter that there's a project coming up in Berlin where 10,000 households going to use smart meters in the near future, and that may be of interest. It's in the Märkisches Viertel here in Berlin. So I guess the people don't have to choose whether they use the old ones or the new ones.
Yeah, maybe. So I'm not from Berlin, I'm from Bochum, but it's quite interesting. Maybe some guy here from Berlin can check it out also.
Hi, I just quickly want to introduce myself to the audience. I'm Nikolaus Staatsra, I'm actually the CEO of Discovergy. And I just want to lay out a couple of words for clarifications. First of all, I'm actually quite proud that we're actually the only utility independent metering operator in Germany. I just want to say this because it's actually tough to be a metering operator. That's no explanation for having those security issues. Yeah, I am terribly sorry for this. And some of them we've resolved. The remaining ones we're working on. And actually, I appreciate the help you guys are giving. And just,
yeah, come here.
Okay. And very briefly, why do we collect per second data? And I think the main reason, the main motivation for our business model is to help individual consumers to reduce their energy use. Yeah, and this is why we collect the detailed data, not to know what you're watching on TV, but to see whether you have an old fridge or an old washing machine, or whether you forgot to turn on off the light or the iron or something like this. Yeah, that's the main reason for collecting the detailed data. Our product is voluntary, yeah, so by definition, you kind of opt in if you become a customer that we collect this data. We'll also give the opportunity to opt out of the detailed data collection. And what else did I want to say? And if any of you is really into maths and statistics and loves to play with data, come up to me later. It's a tough problem. Discovering what you watch on TV might be the easy part of it. There's lots of hard problems still to be solved. If you like these kind of problems, please talk to me later.
So maybe even some questions to Nikolaus?
I think there's a question over here. Dear Audio Angel, do you have a question there?
Do you have a question still?
Yes. Based on the data you already have, do you think you will find a new profile, a payment profile for this guy?
If he's still the Stadtwerke Bochum, I'm 100% sure that we can, yes.
Uh, Well, since you're here, we have been speculating a bit about the business model, but you might be very well placed to explain what exactly is it you're trying to run the company of.
Sure. So we've got three main revenue streams. One is that we charge you something for the installation of the meter and for the running of the meter. So we take 5 euros per month, 60 euros per year. But you save at the same time the money you pay in your like base fee to your current utility company, which is around 20, 25 euros. Yeah. So your additional cost is 30 to 40 euros if you use our service. And we also, like, we don't do that yet, but we intend to earn commissions when we recommend you to change your energy provider. And also, if we tell you, buy this new energy efficient fridge, then possibly the manufacturer or the retailer pays us a finder's fee for recommending those products. But in any case, will be as neutral as algorithmically possible to recommend you the products in your interest rather than maximizing commissions or whatever. And just one point, I think it makes a lot of sense to provide this business model independent of the utilities, because if you think of it, a utility will never tell you go to another utility because it's a bit cheaper, and a utility has no inherent interest to tell you where you're wasting energy. Yeah, they want to sell you as much kilowatt hours and not as little. And I think that makes us unique, even if we still have a lot of work to do.
Could you decrease these 2 seconds, or rather increase it to say once an hour if the individual customer wanted that?
In fact, we plan to give our customers the option to, like, just on your web browser, you can go into, what is it, privacy mode or a surf incognito. You could say, do not store per second level, but just take a daily measurement or 15-minute measurement. We need some measurements, obviously, to give to the utility for billing purposes, but obviously we don't need per second values. So we will create the opportunity to opt out of per second measurements.
Okay, so you said that there is two basic purposes. The one is to find the right tariff, for which I think the presenter has shown quite reasonably that per day data, or maybe even per month data, would be sufficient for finding the right utility to pay. And the second one you mentioned was the sort of educational goal. Seeing the energy consumption of certain devices within your power consumption. Now, as the presenter has also said, for this it would not be necessary for the data to be sent over the internet. In fact, it would be easier and even more fault-proof if the data were only accessible on the local area network of the person's home. So it would never have to leave the person's home. Why is it being sent over the internet? Is it because you think it would be easier for people to handle, or is it because you want the data for something else?
Okay, I think it's mostly a question of philosophy, what's the right approach. The other company which offers a smart meter to you across Germany is Yellow. They actually follow the other policy. They have the granular data only locally. But if you speak to the people at Yellow and to the field technicians, it is actually a nightmare to have this local area network. Like, you swap out your DSL provider, you have a new DSL box, a new router. It's a lot easier to get the data to a central place in the internet, to access it through the browser, rather than setting it up the local infrastructure. So it's just, I think from a usability perspective, it's superior. Also, it's superior because now you're sitting here in the Congress. Maybe you were wondering whether before you left your house, you turned off your cooking or left the light on or something like this. If the data is contained locally, maybe you, because you know how to access remotely your house, you can access it. But the ordinary person will have great difficulty with this. And also, we want to be able in the future to send you an alert if you're not at home and you forgot to turn off, like, you know, your cooking equipment and stuff like that. And all those things are obviously impossible to do if the data never leaves your house. Yeah, so. So, give us a little bit of time, but you can. You'll use a mobile app, which we'll provide, and obviously you give us, you know, you opt in to share this information with you, with us, if you do. But you're not forced to do that, obviously.
I would have another question to the original speaker. Sorry for interrupting your plug, Nicolas.
Thank you.
Your analysis refers or is based on the 2-second interval. Now, we've been speaking a lot about the DiscoverG solution. I wonder, are you aware of any other companies or utilities that do have a similar solution that has a 2-second interval for transmitting the data to a central point?
Yeah, we showed up. The only thing we had have been in our laboratory or in their laboratory. I'm not sharing the laboratory with him. How is it? This three smart meters, and there was the smart meter is every time the same. So the downer part, which measures the power consumption, is every time the same. And the smart meter, which sends this data, there are two other we looked at. And one is called Theben Connexa, and it sends one value every 10 seconds, and the other one value every 2 seconds. And other, I don't aware that there are others, I don't know.
Right, now these are technical solutions for implementing such a thing. I wonder, are you aware of any other utilities, because I am not, that uses the 2-second intervals? As far as I know, all other utilities do use a 15-minute interval.
Yeah.
That's correct.
Yeah, so sure. Don't know
about. It's just about, because you on some slides you said, if you know the MAC address, you can do that for any smart meter.
Yeah.
And you're not referring that to the DiscoverG solution, because that's, I think, that's an important point. As far as I know, DiscoverG is the only one who transfers that 2-second interval. 15-minute interval is bad, but 2-second interval is a bit worse even.
Yeah, but yes, to fake it, it was based on DiscoverG, because we looked only at the packets from DiscoverG. If other encrypt or sign it, we don't know. This two don't, or no, this is not sending, how was it working?
The last one, the Comet, doesn't send any data to the internet. You just open a TCP stream, port 5000, and then it sends the data only to you. With the Theben Connexa, we've didn't try it. So it's we've seen the data rate is nearly 10 seconds and broke up at this point.
The point I'm trying to make is some people might have the impression that a 15-minute interval is a lot better, or, well, not as bad as the 2-second interval. So I think that they would get the wrong point. So that's just that's an important issue, I think.
Yeah, sure. The point is that when you have the 15-minute interval, maybe some privacy issues don't occur. You are surely not able to see the phone, but the possibility to fake the packets, it's the same. When they are not secured, you can fake them as well.
Okay, so we have only 2 minutes left. So any very, very important questions here? Very, very important, please. Oh, we have the IRC now. We need to take care of the guys in the IRC, you know.
Yeah, there's a question here to the CEO. Are you planning to update the smart meters to do only signed and encryption communication with the servers?
Definitely, that's for sure. And those guys have offered their help to make sure that not only we think it's secure, but they also think it's secure.
Thank you very much to the gentleman who did this work. It's fantastic. Speaking as someone who's developing a competitor product where we do all the processing in the home, I was wondering what kind of interface would you guys like to see on the process data that both Discovery and Navitas are looking to generate in the home?
I don't understand.
So I work for a company that is also looking at this high-res data very quickly. We're doing the disaggregation as well. But we do it in the home, in the unit itself. what kind of interface would you guys like onto that data, perhaps without it getting out into the internet?
Yeah, I think a real good, as the data has to be transferred to the internet, some data, so each day or each hour, then I would like to have the same interface, so like the Ethernet interface for my local area network, like we discussed before, and then or with an application to get the data or with a web interface.
Great, thank you.
So, and this is it, the time is off. Thank you very much.